Want to become instant BFFs with a bunch of biologists? Hey, how do new species form? And that's because this is one of the most exciting questions in biology. How did the incredible diversity of life on Earth come about? That bunch of biologists happens to include some of the world's experts on this question, and we get to spend the day inside their lab at the beautiful Arnold Arboretum of Harvard University learning about what they do. And guiding us on our journey is their fearless leader, Dr. Robin Hopkins, Associate Professor of Biology at Harvard.
Hi, Molly. It's so good to see you again. So as scientists, we're really interested in how all this amazing biological diversity on our planet is both formed and sticks around. To find out, we study speciation. This is the evolution process of one species splitting into two species. As they split, the two species wind up evolving different characteristics, and that's what generates all this beautiful diversity we see in nature.
But evolving those differences can take hundreds of thousands of years, right? How do you study something like that in a lab?
It leaves behind clues that we can observe and study now. A fundamental part of these species becoming separate is that they have to stop successfully reproducing with each other and sharing genes. These are the differences that evolved to make the species what they are, but also what keep the species apart now. We do our research in a wildflower called Phlox, and we study each stage of its life cycle to figure out how it evolved traits to make sure it reproduces within a species and not between species.
So let's go on a trip around the life cycle of a phlox plant and learn how the scientists in Robin's lab are studying speciation at all these different stages.
All aboard the speciation mobile! Once a flower is open, its main purpose is to get pollen for successful reproduction. They often do this by attracting animal pollinators. My graduate student, Austin, is exploring how phlox flowers can manipulate pollinators so they can get more pollen from their own species and less from other species.
Hey, Molly, welcome to the lab.
Oh, thanks.
Here I have for you some different species of phlox.
Great.
So this is a phlox species,
and this is another phlox species.
Love it.
This is one too.
Oh,
you can
better.
See they all look pretty similar, but check out this phlox species.
What's up with that one?
So what we know is that these two closely related species live together in nature, and they share a common pollinator, which is a butterfly. We know that the two species can reproduce with each other, but actually the difference in flower color from this light purple to dark red prevents that from happening. It acts as a barrier to preventing their reproduction. We know that the evolution of different flower colors between these species manipulates the behavior of their shared butterfly, so that the butterfly only moves pollen between flowers of the same color. The change in flower color between the species effectively prevents them from mating with each other.
Whoa, so speciation can happen just by evolving slight changes to a flower's appearance?
Exactly right. And we know that this can be due to a relatively simple genetic change. I am studying the genetic basis of the difference in flower color between these two species, and we know that the difference between being light and dark is controlled by just a single gene.
What?
So in dark plants, I can turn that gene off and we get light-colored flowers.
Okay, how cool is it that you can zoom all the way in and figure out which little piece of DNA is keeping those species separate?
It's awesome! So Austin showed us how a flower can control what pollen it receives. Now the pollen has an epic adventure ahead of it. Pollen grains contain plant sperm. When a pollen grain lands on the pistil of a flower, it grows a tube for its sperm to travel through to reach the egg at the bottom of the pistil. The sperm fertilizes the egg, and that results in a seed. My graduate student, Grace, will tell us all about how important this pollen adventure is for speciation.
Hey, Grace. So Austin just told us that a flower's color can influence which pollen is delivered, but I'm guessing like there's still a pretty big chance that pollinators or even the wind could deliver a lot of rando pollen. How do you deal with that if you're a flower?
So that's actually a really big problem that flowering plants need to solve. But don't worry, plants actually have the power to choose the pollen that they want and reject the pollen that they don't want. And a lot of that comes down to being able to recognize whether the pollen is from your own species or from another species. And I'm studying this recognition system in Phlox. So right now I'm using something called a scanning electron microscope, which essentially just lets me zoom in really close on each little pollen grain once it gets to the flower. So that's what you're seeing here. If the pollen is from the same species, the flower will send a signal that says, sure, let's get started reproducing. But if the pollen is from a different species, the flower will send a signal that says, no, thank you. So this recognition system is an important barrier for keeping these species separate. What I'm finding in Phlox is that this signal happens right when the pollen lands at the flower, so before the pollen can even germinate. And something that's really cool is I'm finding that some species are much better at shutting down these wrong kinds of pollen than other species are.
Whoa.
We've just learned a lot about the ways plants have evolved barriers that decrease mating with other species. But what happens when we actually do get successful pollination between species? My postdoc, Anna, is going to tell us all about it.
Hey, Anna.
Well, hi, Molly. Welcome to our beautiful greenhouses. So about seeds, making healthy seeds is really important for a flower because they provide all the nutrients for its offspring to start their lives. And I've been crossing a whole bunch of different species with each other to see how well they do in making seeds. Crossing means I manually transfer pollen from one flower to another, so I'm essentially forcing pollination to happen. And I'm finding that when I cross within a species, they make seeds that look healthy and will probably grow up into healthy adult plants. But when I cross between different species, the seeds are smaller, sometimes all shriveled up, and will probably not grow up into healthy adult plants.
Okay, so even if pollen gets through and fertilizes an egg, there can be this additional barrier that prevents a successful seed from being formed.
Yes, and we can then test how intense this barrier is by checking if any of these seeds can germinate and actually grow up into healthy adult plants.
Oh, cool.
If they don't, this is a really solid barrier because it puts an end to any further reproduction. To figure out what exactly makes this barrier so strong and what prevents hybrid seeds from developing normally, we will have to dive deeper into the genetics of these plants. But sometimes even hybrid seeds germinate.
But wait, if the seeds germinate, does that mean they've overcome all of the barriers to reproduction and the two species aren't really separate?
Oh, Molly, it's time for you to meet my research assistant, Izzy.
Okay, Izzy, help me out because I am in a speciation spiral.
Well, you see, even with all these barriers to reproduction, sometimes two species, like these, can still form a hybrid baby that grows up and flowers. But don't worry, there can still be a major barrier keeping them separate at this point. This hybrid can be sterile.
Whew, okay, so that means the baby can't reproduce, right? That seems like a pretty solid barrier to me.
So actually, there are different levels of sterility. And the combination of parent species, like these, can affect how bad it is. One way we can measure this is by taking pollen from our hybrids and looking at it under the microscope. We can use a special dye that stains the good pollen pink and leaves the bad pollen green. And as you can see, some hybrids produce big, happy pollen grains, while others produce lots of small, malformed pollen grains that probably won't work.
No.
So I'm studying all of these hybrids that result from crossing different species, and I'm asking what causes their sterility, what genes contribute to this, and what combinations of parent species lead to a hybrid being more or less sterile.
Robin, how cool is it that we've been around the whole Phlox life cycle and seen barriers that keep species separate every step of the way?
Around and around again, from pollen to seed, to plant, to flower, and back to pollen. It's a process that's been playing out across millions of individuals, across millions of years.
But how do we look that far into the past?
I think I know a guy. You gotta meet my postdoc, Felix.
So Felix, I hear you have a Phlox time machine.
I do indeed. It's genome, its complete set of DNA. So this little guy got its genome half from its mom, half from its dad. And so if we look at the genome of this little fella, we learn something about its plant's parents, those plant's parents, and those plant's parents all the way into the distant past. And if we look at lots of plants' genomes, we can learn something about when the different species split apart in the past and whether they've ever come back together to form hybrids. These different processes leave lots of scars and patterns in the genomes of these plants, which we can discover by using powerful computers to analyze their DNA sequences.
All right, don't leave us hanging. What have you learned so far?
We've been studying these species of Phlox from the state of Texas, and using our time machine, we found that in one pair of species, they've been hybridizing and reproducing distantly in the past and even now in the present. We're still trying to understand when these different barriers between the Texas phlox species arose and why some, but not all of them, have weakened over time. It's a real team project. Many lab members, both past and present, have contributed their expertise to this effort.
Speaking of teamwork, want to rejoin the group?
Yes.
So Molly, how did new species form?
Well, we are at Harvard, so I guess I should have known there'd be a test at the end.
Okay.
They form by evolving color differences to influence their pollinators, choosing which pollen is allowed to fertilize their eggs, not letting seeds develop properly, causing hybrids to be sterile, and even though species could have started splitting apart millions of years ago, they are still very much keeping that split going today. How'd I do, Professor?
A plus. Yeah. Each one of those answers is correct.
And it almost always takes multiple barriers evolving in combination to make species separate and keep them apart. Part of the excitement of this field is really diving into this complexity.
Incredible biological diversity requires equally diverse approaches to studying it.